Chapter 11, Muscular System, Axial and Appendicular Muscles, Part 1. So, muscles, their general arrangement, muscles are usually attached to bones, and they usually cross at least one joint. So, part of the muscle will be on one side of the joint and on the other side, although in this case, we see that this muscle is crossing two joints. The origin of the muscle is where the muscle attachment is less mobile. So little to no movement occurs at the origin. It's on one side of the joint, and then on the other side of the joint is the insertion. And the insertion is the movable end. This is where movement is going to occur. Muscle fascicles, the fascicles within the muscles, can be arranged in different manners. You can have a circular arrangement, for instance, orbicularis oris around the mouth. It inserts into itself. Parallel, the muscle fibers all run in the same orientation and also run parallel to the midline. We have convergent, where the muscle fascicles are all converging down to a point. And then we also have the pinnate formation, which is actually has three subcategories. Unipinnate, the tendon is along one side, and the muscle fascicles insert into it on that one side. Bipinnate, the tendon runs down the middle, and the fascicles insert on either side, sort of like a feather. And then multipinnate, the tendon branches into different branches, and each branch then has the fascicles inserting into them. So circular, parallel, convergent, pinnate. Pinnate has unipinnate, bipinnate, and multipinnate. All right, muscles are usually arranged in groups depending on their primary actions. And some of the muscles are going to do the opposite action of others. So for instance, here we have the arm, here's the elbow. We have on one side the biceps brachii, on the other side the triceps brachii. The biceps brachii, if we wanted to flex the arm to make the forearm come closer to the arm part, biceps brachii will contract, and it would be then called the agonist. So the agonist is the muscle that is contracting, the muscle that is causing the movement to occur. Then on the other side is the antagonist. The antagonist, in this case triceps brachii, is going to relax. Triceps brachii relaxes, stretches, and allows the movement to occur. So they're not working against each other. It's just one group, when it works and activates, needs the other group to relax at the same time. Agonists contract, generate force in the movement. Antagonists relax, allow it to occur. There are also often muscles called synergists. Synergists assist the agonists a little bit. So for instance, we have biceps brachii here, a third muscle. They may help generate the tension, the force that caused the movement, or they may be stabilizing the origin so it's not moving. They may be stabilizing at the joint so that the movement is nice and smooth. Basically, they're assisting in making the process more effective and smooth. All right, muscles are named based on various characteristics. For instance, they can be named based on their primary action. So we've got flexors, extensors, pronators. Flexor carpi radialis muscle is a flexor. It's causing flexion. They can also be named by specific regions of the body. So for instance, tibialis anterior, it's on the anterior surface of the tibia. They can be named whether they're close to the surface or not. If they're close to the surface, they can be called superficialis or externus. If they're deeper muscles further away from the surface, they can be called profundus or internus. They can be named by their attachments, by their origins and insertions. So usually the first part would be the origin and the second part the insertion. Here, this muscle is sternocleidomastoid. Sterno is attached to the sternum, cleido for clavicle. That's its origins, and then its insertion is the mastoid process of the temporal bone, sternocleidomastoid. Muscles can also be named based on their orientations. That is the relative orientation of the fascicles compared to, say, the midline. So rectus muscles, their fascicles are in parallel and all going in the same direction in parallel with the midline. Then we have the obliques. Obliques are going at an angle compared to the midline. You can also name muscles based on their shape. So deltoid for triangular, rhomboid for rhombus-shaped, orbicularis for circular, trapezius for trapezoid-shaped, brevis for short, longus for long, many more. You can also name muscles based on their relative size to other similar muscles. So we got magnus for big, maximus for biggest, minor for small, minimus for smallest. So for instance, here is gluteus maximus. Under gluteus maximus is gluteus medius. Under gluteus minimus is gluteus minimus. You can also name muscles based on the numbers of origins. So the biceps brachii, biceps, has two origins. Triceps brachii, triceps, has three origins. All right, we're going to start talking about some of the axial muscles, muscles attached along the midline of the skeleton, the axial skeleton. So first up, occipital frontalis. Occipital frontalis goes from the back of the head, where the occipital bone is, to the front of the head, where the frontalis, the frontal bone, is. Occipital frontalis is inserting into skin, not bone. And when occipital frontalis contracts, it wrinkles the forehead, raises the eyebrows, and wrinkles the forehead. Then we have buccinator. Buccinator muscle, one on each side, is a deep muscle. You can see how it's under the mandible, under other muscles. The buccinator on either side of the cheeks helps to compress the cheeks. And this can be helpful when holding food in the mouth or, say, when whistling. So buccinator, a deep muscle that helps to contract, to compress the cheeks. We have orbicularis oculi. There are two of these, one around each eye. Orbicularis circular, oculi around the eye. We have orbicularis oris. Orbicularis oris goes around the mouth. There's only one of these. The orbicularis oculi, when they contract, they close the eyes or allow us to blink. When orbicularis oris contracts, it closes the mouth, and if you contract really hard, can even give you a little kissy face. All right, then we have zygomaticus major. Zygomaticus major goes from the zygomatic bone to the corner of the mouth. And then we have depressor anguli oris. Depressor anguli oris going from the mandible to the corner of the mouth. When the depressor anguli oris contracts, it pulls the ends of the mouth down, giving you a frown. When zygomaticus major contracts, it pulls up on the corners of the mouth, giving you a smile. Then we have levator labii superioris, levator labii superioris right around here. It inserts into the upper lip, and it will raise the upper lip. So if one contracts, you get one side. Both of them contract, you get both sides. We have depressor labii inferioris, inserting into the lower lip, and also mentalis, another muscle at the chin. And then a third muscle here is the corrugator supercilii, right up here. Now, the depressor labii inferioris, when it contracts, pulls the lower lip down. When the mentalis muscles on the chin contract, they cause the lower lip to stick out, to elevate and protrude, giving a pouty face. And then finally, when the corrugator supercilii muscles contract, they will depress the eyebrows. It says lip, that is wrong. They depress the eyebrows, cause you to scowl. All right, platysmus. Platysma is a muscle that's a thin sheet of a muscle that goes from our shoulder all the way up into our lower part of our face. And the platysma, two of them on each side, very thin muscle, and it will cause pulling down of the lips, and also a tension in the neck, skin of the neck. So you can try that on your own. That's the platysma muscles. All right, muscles that move the eye. There are six muscles that insert into the eye and move the eye. Four of these are the rectus muscles. So we have the superior rectus muscle, the medial rectus muscle, the lateral rectus muscle, and the inferior rectus muscle. They have their origins in the back of the orbit, and they insert to the front of the eye. Here is lateral rectus, superior rectus, inferior rectus. And what they do is move the eye in the same direction they are located. So medial rectus moves the eye medially, lateral rectus moves the eye laterally, superior rectus moves the eye superiorly and a little medially, inferior rectus moves the eye inferiorly and a little bit medially. We also have the obliques. There is the superior oblique, starts at its origin in the back of the eye, goes around, goes through a piece of connective tissue to then connect to the back of the eye. So again, it goes up, does a U-turn, connects to the back of the eye. And then we have the inferior oblique. Inferior oblique's origins in the front of the orbit, and it inserts into the back of the eye. So right here would be the inferior oblique. And you can see a piece of the superior oblique. Now the obliques, they move the eye opposite the direction they're located. So superior oblique moves the eye inferiorly and a little bit laterally. The inferior oblique moves the eye superiorly and a little bit laterally. So the obliques move it in the opposite direction they're located. And here you can see how five of the muscles have their origins in the back of the orbit, the inferior oblique being the one that doesn't. All right, moving on to muscles related to mastication or chewing. We have the temporalis muscle on either side of the head, going from the temporal bone down to the mandible. We have the masseter muscle going from the zygomatic bone down to the mandible. And then deep or underneath the mandible, we have the medial pterygoid connecting down to the mandible. All three of these muscles do the same thing. They help to elevate the mandible. So all three muscles, temporalis, masseter, and medial pterygoid, all help to elevate, to raise up the mandible. And also they do a little bit of other things. Temporalis also helps to retract the mandible. So if it's jutting out, to pull it back in. Masseter can protract the mandible, can jut it out. And the medial pterygoid can also protract the mandible and move the mandible from side to side, laterally from side to side. Another muscle for mastication is a lateral pterygoid. There's the lateral pterygoid. Again, it's a deep muscle, so we need to cut away a lot of bone in the skull to see it. And it will insert into the mandible, of course. And its job is to protract and depress the mandible. So it can help to lower the mandible, depress the mandible. And it also can help to move the mandible from side to side. So lateral pterygoid depresses the mandible. We do need to have some control when we lower our jaw. We don't usually just let gravity pull it down. We also have a series of muscles in the throat that are important for swallowing or deglutination. The superior pharyngeal constrictor, the medial pharyngeal constrictor, and the inferior pharyngeal constrictor. So that when we swallow, when we push food into the back of our throat, they will contract sequentially to propel the food down into the esophagus. We don't really control these muscles. They sort of happen automatically, so that once you swallow, once you move food to the back of the throat, superior pharyngeal constrictor will constrict, sending it down a little further. The medial pharyngeal constrictor will constrict, sending it down even further. And then the inferior pharyngeal constrictor will constrict, sending it into the esophagus, and from the esophagus down to the stomach. And that is where we'll stop with this part of the lecture.